Hi guys, how are you doing? Welcome back to my channel. This is the Littlebean and Me podcast channel. I'm your host, Kayleen. I am the principal fiber artist and yarn dyer behind Littlebean Loves Hand Painted Yarn and Littlebean Crochet on Etsy. I do a new website, which is www.littlebeanlovesyarn.com, and you can find all my hand dyed yarns there. I do have a little blog, which is right now just homing a link for the podcast, but I plan to do some on-topic posts in the blog. But anyway, as you can see, we are in a somewhat new location. Well, new to you, not so much to me. This is my spare room, which is the guest room slash yarn room slash workout room. Right now you are perched on a couple of boxes on my elliptical machine in front of the window, so we have good light. And yeah, it's crazy. So this room is now kind of organized and houses all of my yarn and supplies and our workstation for both me and my husband when he works from home. And so yeah, I thought I would film in here today for a couple of reasons. One, because I wanted to try out a new filming location, but also today's Monday and my daughter is not in school today, so she doesn't go to school until Tuesdays and Fridays, and I wanted to film an update for you today because I didn't have a chance to on Friday. And I do have some progress to show you, thankfully. So let's just get right into it. So a little bit about the room. This room is our spare room, which also doubles as a guest room for when we have family come to visit. And it's also our workout room where you're perched on the elliptical machine. And this whole entire wall behind me is brand new shelving that I bought from IKEA. This is the Calax collection, I believe. It's just the cubed shelves. It's one of their more popular collections. But also right here on the front of the shelving unit, I mounted one of their tables. So we have a nice shallow but long desk space for this room because we are limited on our floor space. You can see here my drying rack. I have some self-striping yarn drying, or well, it's dry now. It just needs to be re-skeined. And yeah, so everything that's right here is all kind of related to my yarn, my stash, and so I suppose I will just clip in here a little tour of the room so you can see what it looks like now. Let's see if this will focus. Yay, it's focusing. Okay. Hey guys. I wanted to insert some footage here of some of my new workspace. So if you guys are following me on social media, on Instagram, on Facebook, or in any of the yarny groups, you'll know that I recently overhauled the office and I got some new tools, which you can see back there. And so I wanted to give you a little tour of this office space. So you guys have seen the office space before. This may look familiar to you. You see our dining room. So if you've seen vlogs that I've done, and then it comes right here into the office, which was a really messy guest room. Dun, 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 dun. So we have this lovely setup in here now. A lot of floor space for my drying rack and fan. And as you can see, it's all IKEA shelving units. That far unit here I had previously, and it's where I keep all of my undyed yarns. You can see some self-striping. That's for my super secret project with Lynn. If you haven't checked her podcast out, you should. This is our desk, which is mounted onto these IKEA shelves. This is a 4x4 unit. I think it's called Calax now. It used to be called Expedit, but it's the same shelf. It's a cube shelf. I have some more of my stash, some more yarn. By the time I'm recording the podcast of the future, you will not see these because these are getting mailed out today, but this is my first official run of self-striping yarns. So I did Narcissa and Bellatrix. So this is Bellatrix, if it will focus. Hello. Here she is. This is Bellatrix. So she's a dark purple with deep purple speckling, like light speckles, and some deeper red tones, as you can see. And then Narcissa, who's also up on my warping mill here, is a pale yellow with some light peachy pinks running through and a solid black. And the other one has a gray tonal.
So you can see her, she's up here on my mill so that I can skein her into a normal size skein. And then today, which you'll probably see again on the official podcast, I scored some Voolenvine. Very excited, I was able to score her Pandora color on the Volca base, which is an MCN, 801010 MCN. And yeah, I was very, very excited. So I just got this in the mail not 5 seconds ago. So I have my office supplies, my packaging and shipping supplies. The yarns that are currently in stock are on these accessible shelves, my very small minis collection. And yeah, just all of my undyed yarns. Down here are some project bags and packing supplies. And down here is my personal yarn stash, which is mostly acrylic. And then this is my photo box. So when I'm taking photos of the yarn, that's where it's happening. So that's the tour of the room. We were still able to keep a bed in here. Our elliptical machine wasn't going anywhere. TV, printer, the whole nine. Everything now fits in here, which is great. If the lighting were not so bad in here for filming, I would be more inclined to podcast in here. If I turn this light, right now I have the stick lamp on so I can see better. As you can see, the lighting's pretty good. It's a bit cold in here in terms of coloring. As you can see, the walls are gray. I don't have a good background. Like, I suppose I could just film in this way, but I would need to have some other lighting from this side. I could turn and face this way, and then I would be facing, this probably is the best light right here. But it's not a very nice background, it's just the closet door at the end of the bed. I don't know, it's not that appealing to me, so. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this little tour that I did. I hopefully didn't make you feel seasick. Now I'm back to reskeining yarn, and I will see you in the future. Alright, so I hope you enjoyed that brief little tour. I apologize for the sounds of frustration in the back, but a three-year-old trying to play by herself, she gets very frustrated and yells. Sorry. And I also apologize for any reflections in my glasses. I've kind of tried to sit in a way where I can see you and you won't get this strange glare, but we'll see. So I'm hoping the lighting's good, so we can just hop right into everything. I wanted to show you my works in progress. I don't have any finished objects to show you today, at least new finished objects. But I do want to show you my socks, which are here. So last you saw, I had just turned the heel of these socks, and I wanted to show you the progress that I have made. So the last time I showed you, I was right about here. And I have knit a pretty significant chunk of the sock. If we're looking at it, heels, folding them down, let's not let the whole sock fall off the needles on the podcast, that'd be awful. If we're looking at how far left I have to go, it's getting a little washed out in here, but I'll have to maybe do some adjustments on lighting. But here's where I've knitted, and then here's the rest of the length of my foot. Obviously that's the cuff part, the top part, but I knitted it the length of my foot. So I have several inches to go on both socks, but over the last couple days I've just been picking this up when I have a spare moment and knitting down the foot. So I'm hoping that these will be done in the next week or so. I really just want to get these off my needles and just be done with them and wear them and enjoy them and stop worrying about why I haven't stitched on them. So these are in my casual fashion queen bag. They're on size 1 Addie Rockets. They are 60 stitches, cuffed down 2 at a time, magic loop method. There you go. There's all the stats. Fish lips kiss you. And then my other work in progress is my crochet granny blanket. And I've made some progress since you last saw it. So here it is. It looks so nice. I love how it looks. It makes me happy. So it's always difficult to show. Maybe I'll just fold it. I think the last piece of it that you saw was this green section here. So I crocheted up the green section, a blue section, the white section, and now we're back onto a blue section. So you can see the stripes are getting larger. I'm sorry. I'm trying to show you a nice spread. There we go. Okay, so you can see that the stripes are getting larger. And I think I'm just going to continue making them larger as it goes up the blanket. So it'll be a nice gradation from narrow stripes to wider stripes. Or I might do wider stripes and then go back down to narrow stripes. I don't really know where this project is going, but it is going along just fine. So I've gotten two large stripes finished on that. There we go. Ooh, reflection. I'm also not wearing my contacts because my eyelid is swollen. I don't know if you guys can see. Oh, not really. It's actually looking better, but you can see it's a little bit red. I don't know why. I don't know why I did that. My eyelid just decided to be swollen yesterday, so I've been in glasses for 2 days now. Alright, so then on to dyeing stuff. Works in progress for dyeing. I have been doing a new project, which is self-striping yarn, and I've showed it to you before, where I had done the super secret project with Lynn, which is still ongoing. I have to dye more for that, but I also want to knit up, part of the reason why I want to finish my socks is because I want to knit up swatches of that yarn to make sure that the striping pattern works the way that I'm thinking it works in my head. But I have made a couple of new colorways in the meantime for self-striping, which have gone up and down and up and down off of the website and on Etsy. And it is the Bellatrix and Narcissa kind of duo. So I took two characters from Harry Potter and I decided I wanted to make a couple of two-stripe self-striping yarns. These have been moving faster than I can process them, so I have to kind of take a moment and wind up all these, ship the ones that have sold, and then relist the ones that I have left, because I think I have 4 left of Bellatrix and that's all I have, which are on the drying rack. I have 2 that are sold that are on the drying rack, and then 4 that have not even been listed yet, but I don't want to list them until I can ship them because I'm rescanning all these yarns by hand. So I'll tell you a little bit about each color and the process that I use to dye. So these are 2-stripe self-striping. I have these in a crochet braid just for the ease of showing you because the skeins are so long. But this is a purple tonal. It has dark spots of a blood red tone and also a dark aubergine that are kind of speckling. This batch had a little bit of blue breakage. I think the aubergine broke when it dyed, but I think it lends a really interesting flare to the yarn. What I mean by when I say it breaks, the dye blends. If you buy pre-made dye blends, they're made of many colors, and some colors absorb faster than other colors in the yarn, and when that happens, the dye will, instead of being absorbed as one unit, it gets absorbed twice. Once for the smaller molecules, and then once the larger molecules finally hit the fiber, you get a separate color. So I think that's what ended up making this break into a little bit of a blue tone, but it just will make more interesting speckling when you stitch it up. So there's a tonal gray, which was just, I used my black, the true black that I used to make black, to make this gray, and then this kind of variegated, but it's tonal, it has all the same types of tones in it, purple. So this is Bellatrix. I also toyed with the idea of putting some like greens in this gray, just to be more like venomous, because that's how Bellatrix is. But I thought maybe I'll just leave it simple, leave it as it is. Getting beeps on my phone. Interruptions! No matter where I am, I'm getting interrupted. So yeah, Bellatrix, there it is. And then this is Narcissa. So Narcissa is a much deeper black, so this is a solid black color. It is pulling, it pulls slightly red, but this batch came out nicely saturated. There we go. This batch came out nicely saturated, where the black is feeling very, very, very solid. So that's the tone that I wanted to have the difference. This to be a tonal gray and this to be more black. And then the yarn itself, the colored stripe, is a yellow. It's a very pale yellow, kind of like Narcissa's hair. but it is also a bit, there we go, this is true to color. This, it has some variegation in it with some light peachy pinks. See some darker spots of yellow. When it's skeined up, it looks much more black and white, but the color, you can see here where it slightly turns pink, there are going to be kind of pink, light pink speckles. And then this is Narcissa skeined up. So of all of these that are sitting behind me, I have two skeined of the eight that need to be skeined. So yeah, I really like these two. I chose the colors for Narcissa because, so her hair is described as, you know, this long pale blonde hair, which is the absolute opposite of Bellatrix, where she has that black wiry hair. But also, the difference between Narcissa and Bellatrix is their capability of love. And that's where I pulled in this pink color. That's coming up very nicely true to color right now. You know, she's very black and white in terms of her personality, and you know, she's very snooty, she's very cold to people that she feels are lesser than her, but it's really the love that she has for her family that ends up turning her against Voldemort in the end, and not giving Harry up to him, saying that he was still alive because she wanted to make sure that her son was okay. So I'm hoping this is coming across well for you, where you can see where it's pale yellow and then there's these peachy tones that are pulling through the yarn. So anyway, so that's what I've been working on. As you can see here, I can pull it over these long skeins, but this is what Bellatrix looks like, not in a braid, not skeined. It's nice, very, not dirty, but just very messy looking in terms of color work, because that's how she is. So, oi, look. All of those need skeining. Oh, okay. So that's what I've been working on in terms of dye work. I don't have any other new colors to show you or new techniques to show you. This is kind of my newest venture. And also, as you saw in the clip before where I showed kind of the tour of the room, you'll see my new toy, which is a toy, my warping mill, so that I can wind different bases and different lengths of skeins so I can do more stripes. And it'll make it a little easier for me. Right now, the supplier I have sells long skeins as is, like they're pre-warped and tied, but they're very fiddly to deal with and they're very fiddly to unwind and reskein into smaller skeins by hand. So I'm thinking that if I'm warping my own fiber, if I'm warping my own yarn, then it'll be easier for me to unwind in the end. So spending that extra time warping might be worthwhile. So, and plus I want to do more color stripes. I wanted to add more than just two. I would like to do a 3-color stripe or a 4 or 5 or 6-color stripe, but I would need to wind very long skeins. So the warping wheel will make that easier for me. Still very time consumptive, but easier in general. Here we go. So then acquisitions. I only have one acquisition, but it's one that I'm very excited about. So a couple of weeks ago, I was able to catch a Voolenvine shop update. She's one of the podcasts that I frequently watch. I really enjoy her crafting style and I enjoy her yarn. At least aesthetically, I enjoy her yarn. I think it's because she does her yarn differently than me. I don't know. I enjoy dyeing yarn the way I do, but it's always refreshing to enjoy other dyers' work, because it's different than how you would normally do it. But that's why I like Gabby's yarn at Once Upon a Corgi. I like her style, and I also like Sheena's, a casual fashion queen. You hear me talk about these folks all the time. I've used Jinx yarns before. I really like the way that she does her striping. It's really cool. And then I finally was able to get a skein of Voolenvine. So I'll show you here. This is a skein of Pandora. And it is very subtle. This is on her Volca base, which is her 80-10-10 merino cashmere nylon, which is a 4-ply fingering weight yarn. It's very similar, or it could even be the same base yarn that I have. It feels very similar, but I really wanted a 4-ply MCN because I like my 4-ply MCN that I dye. So it's a very nice, lightly speckled yarn. It has pinks, some slight turns of orange, and black. Yeah, very, very, very subtle and very beautiful. So I was excited. I tried to get my hands on as many as I could. I had like my cart all set up and my login all set up and my payment information all in. And when I went click, click, click and went to checkout, this was the only one that I was able to keep in my cart because all of the others had been claimed. So I think that's just how it goes with her yarns. They're very in demand. But I'm excited to put this in a project and I'm excited. Maybe I'll knit a pair of socks out of this or even put this into a shawl, my next fingering weight shawl. I would like to put this in. It's very, very soft and lovely, and I'm very excited for it. So that's my only acquisition. And then something else that I wanted to talk about today. I don't have any questions. I didn't solicit for any, you know, ask me anythings. I checked the Ravelry group, which we have as a Ravelry group, and nobody had posted, which is totally fine. It's a quiet group. I'm not super active on Ravelry, so I'm not... you know, promoting chatter on the page, but it's nice to have that page in case people want to talk about the podcast or talk or ask questions to me as a dyer or, you know, just as a fellow fiber lover. And anyway, so we have a Ravelry group. That's the main message here. But I wanted to do like a little on-topic chat. I was watching the new format. Andi has a new format on her Andre Sue Knits podcast where she talks about, you know, different topics in knitting, and it's a very nicely put together series that she's been doing. It's very polished, it's well edited, it's very clear. It's as concise as you can be if you're wanting to do, you know, this step-by-step type of format. So I appreciate that a lot, and I really appreciate and respect the amount of time and effort that goes into making a video like that. Even videos like this where I have an agenda or I have a certain script or order of things in mind, it takes a lot of discipline to stay on topic and to stay within a certain time frame. So applause to Andi if you're watching this. It's coming out great. But she talked about t-shirt yarn. Let's talk about being concise while I go on a tangent. So she talked about t-shirt yarn. 2 weeks ago, I think it was 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, she talked about t-shirt yarn, and then she's talked about needlework and beading. I think maybe it's just 2 weeks. Anyway, so in recent weeks, she talked about making your own t-shirt yarn and what to do and using your own t-shirt yarn. And that's something that I have experience with, that I've crafted with before, so I wanted to chat about it. It's one of my more favorite mediums, one because it's a change in material. Sometimes you get burnt out on stitching up the same types of materials all the time, so you want to change it up. T-shirt yarn is a great way to go. It's a great way to upcycle old t-shirts that you may have lying around, especially jersey fabric works really well for making yarn, and it gives it another purpose in your house, whether it's you're making a bowl or a bath mat or a decorative, you know, throw for your bed. It really kind of gives new life to an object that you might otherwise donate or throw away. And so I wanted to talk about the t-shirt yarn that I've used, because I've used handmade t-shirt yarn and I've also used commercially cut t-shirt yarn, and I like both. I would never dye my own t-shirt yarn because I'm not really into dyeing plant fibers, you know, because they just take so much longer and so much more effort. But I want to show you this box. So in the video, the clip that I showed you earlier where we did a little tour of the room, you saw this box full of yarn. So I wanted to pull it over and show it to you. So this is my big box of t-shirt yarn. This used to be in a, you know, wicker box. It's kind of blowing me out a little bit. It used to be in a wicker box that sat at the end of the bed. And since we cleaned up, I wanted to move it onto a proper shelf. So this t-shirt yarn is all
pre-made t-shirt yarn. So I have some of them, well, I don't think I have the other skein in here, but I had two skeins of this. This is a rainbow t-shirt yarn made by Chenapenna Creations on Etsy. Here is her logo. And it is a hand-dyed, hand-cut t-shirt yarn. So she cuts the shirts and dyes it up and makes the yarn. This stripes up, kind of. It has shorter transitions. But what I purchased these for was I was making friends and family and selling, also I was selling teething rings. And I would crochet the t-shirt yarn onto the teething rings, which is a great idea. And if you're gifting, if you're a crocheter, and you can find compliant, safe teethers, wooden teethers or silicone teethers, you can crochet your own t-shirt yarn onto it if you so choose. But I stopped doing that because I wanted to crochet more, like crochet other things, and I also wanted to get into dyeing yarn, so I stopped doing that. But this is the yarn. It is just made from plain jersey fabric, and she sells them by the small cake like this, and I believe this is 60 yards of fabric. So I have one of these, and then the remainder of my t-shirt yarn is commercially cut jersey fabric yarn. And I use these to make bowls. So I was making and selling bowls as well on my Etsy shop. And I would purchase different patterns of t-shirt yarn and stitch up bowls and sell them. So they come in large or small. This is the company that I purchased from. This is Fabuloop. They are on Etsy. They also have their own separate website, and they are in New Jersey. So this is a nice kind of like forest green color. You can see it's kind of, it's weird how the lighting is in here, so I apologize for things getting blown out. This is very true to color here. So it's a forest green. I have some red, which is really bright, and it's coming up true to color there. Some creams, some purples, this nice coral color. And then this one has got to be my favorite one. This is navy and green stripes. And so what I will do is take it, stitch it, make it into a bowl, and use it for different things. A lot of people like to use them as fruit bowls, or, you know, if you make nice long skinny ones, you can use them as pencil bowls. I have a pattern that I will put in the description box below, and that is the pattern that I use to make bowls. It's a very simple, kind of a beanie style pattern where you pretty much make it like you would make a beanie hat, except instead of putting it on your head, you're putting it on a table. So I will put that in the description box below. It's a very simple pattern. I'm not going to charge money for it. It's nothing big. But you use a 10 millimeter crochet hook, a ball of t-shirt yarn, or your own upcycled t-shirt yarn, and you just have at it. It makes a nice large bowl, probably about this size, deep enough for fruit or for other things. People use them for kids, for changing table bowls to hold, you know, diaper cream or other knickknacks that you need for babies. You need a lot of things for babies, or for toys. So yeah, have fun with it. T-shirt yarn is a real fun medium. I can make a bath mat out of this. Well, not out of one of these, but out of a couple of these, I can make a nice size bath mat. And you just have fun. You just go. Make whatever you feel like making. It doesn't matter what you make things out of. Even, you know, if you're using craft store yarn, or you're using t-shirt yarn, or you're using expensive wool or cashmere or silk, it doesn't matter. If you like what you're making, just keep making it. So yeah, so this is t-shirt yarn. This is jersey material, so I can show you close up, I suppose, now that I've rambled a bit. What's a podcast without rambling? Okay, so you can see the strips of fabric here. Here it is. It's coming up nice, true to color here. So this is the t-shirt yarn. And if you're cutting this from your own t-shirts, you'd cut your strips, and then what you would do is you would pull the yarn tight. So so that it's not going to stretch any further. Here's a really nice elastic one. This has to have some elastane in it. So here is the strips of yarn. Let's see if it will focus not on me. There we go. And then see how this has some stretch. So you want to pre-stretch and pre-pull your yarn once you cut it. So I think Andi does do a demonstration where she cuts the yarn and then she shows you how to pull and pull and pull the knit to make sure that it doesn't continue to grow or stretch when you stitch with it. So yeah, I mean, I can show you some pictures. I guess I'll put up a picture of a bowl here or here in one of these places, whichever fits the picture better, of the bowls that I make. So it's very easy. It's very fun. You can really do a lot with t-shirt yarn. So I definitely recommend picking some up. I'll leave a link below for where I purchase the yarn. Yeah. So Fabuloop, they're great, very good customer service. I've had very good communications with them. I was buying these in much larger quantities, so I was able to chat with them frequently about, you know, how much is in stock or like when they're getting other patterns or colors or whatnot. So definitely go check out them. Okay, let's put this away. Anyway, that's about all I have for you today. I don't have much else to talk to you about in terms of daily life bits, blabble, you know, the things that are happening in my life are not that exciting. I'm a mom of two very little kids and every day feels very much the same. So outside of my dye work or my stitching, we don't really do very many interesting things or anything interesting that would be worthwhile to share here. I mean, we go on play dates and go for walks and go to the park and it's really nice, but yeah, you know, we just try and keep it interesting, take advantage of the warm weather we've been having, the unusually warm January weather, which is nice and fine, but makes me a little concerned, but it's fine. But yeah, so I hope you guys enjoyed. If you've enjoyed and you're still hanging around, don't forget to give me a thumbs up down below. It lets me know that you're liking the content or you like the things that I have to say. If you'd like to be and you're not already, you can always hit subscribe. There's usually a button right down below the video that will allow you to subscribe to my channel. And if you'd like to receive pop-up notifications every time I'm uploading a video, you can always click the little bell that's next to the subscribe button below. And it will let you know exactly when I upload a video. So it'll send you a push notification to your phone or your email, whatever you choose, wherever you choose to get your notifications. And that way you don't miss anything. So with that being said, I think we'll close it out for today. I hope you guys have an enjoyable week. I'm filming on an odd day and I'm uploading on an odd day, so I don't know if I'll have another video up for the end of the week, but if there's a specific topic you'd like me to talk about, let me know, or a demonstration, I'm happy to do those things, make a separate video, or if you have a question you'd like to be answered, I'm also happy to make a separate video to answer questions. Yeah, just let me know in the comments down below. Let's have a chat. Our little chat about product versus process was great, so let's leave some comments. Let me know what you'd like to see on this channel. All right, I will see you guys in my next video. Have a great week. Bye.